So welcome to my talk about Atomic.h weapons, or more precisely, QEMU and the C11 memory model. First of all, I'm not an expert on this stuff. Herb Sutter and the C11, C++11 guys are the experts. This is what you want to read or watch to really learn about this stuff. Herb Sutter's talks are like 5 hours. I will try to condense them in 30 minutes because I have to talk about QEMU as well. So you can go really in depth about this stuff. This is my outline. Short introduction about what atomics are, about what compilers do, which is going to be surprising, I hope. And then something about atomics in QEMU, finally, and future work with atomic.h. So who ordered atomics? Problems with coarse-grained locks is that they don't scale. Problems with finer-grained locks is that you get deadlocks. Leaf locks are easy. If you don't have any nesting of locks, it's all great. But as soon as you call, for example, a callback with a lock taken, you have to really, really think about what you're doing. Also, taking a lock many times is slow. So basically, let's see how you can define atomics in a very simple way. It's like a really, really fine-grained locks, extremely fine-grained, and faster because actually it's not a lock. Atomics provide basically two things. A way to order reads and writes so that the compiler, the processor, really do what you think you're doing, and I'll get back to this later. And also a primitive that is atomic compare and swap. It's like what I wrote there, but that's not C, of course, because there's that T, which is a kind of polymorphic type, but also because the thing happens atomically, of course. So the processor reads a value, compares to something, and if it's equivalent or equal to the expected value, writes the desired value, and nothing else happens in the middle. This is done with magic at the cache level and at the bus level. And some processors don't have compare and exchange. They have dot locks or conditional, which for the purposes of this talk are the same. And everything else, like test and set, fetch and add, can be built on top of ordering of read and writes and compare and swap. So basically, when do you end up using atomics? When threads communicate at well-defined points, it's easy to make things consistent, isolated, and durable, then why not make them atomic as well and get all the acid properties. So in fact, that's the case with ring buffers, for example. In that case, you don't even need compare and swap, you just need reads and writes. In some cases, you really have such a minimal consistency requirement that it's not worth doing anything more consistent. Like, if you have statistics, you don't really care if you actually have done a read from disk, but you have not yet accounted for it, or vice versa, if maybe you account for one more read, but that read hasn't actually hit the disk. It's not going to make a big difference. These are the easy ones. The more complicated ones are when you can abstract stuff, and the outside world sees something indistinguishable from actually using locks, then you can get nice scalability improvements by using atomics. And of course, if you're using synchronization primitives, you cannot go mutexes all the way down. Sooner or later, you have to get something else in that's atomics. Another good idea is to use atomics combined with locks. So this fast path is going to use atomics, and the slow path is going to use locks. For example, RCU and seclock use atomics on the read side and mutexes on the write side. Pthread ones, as we'll see later, also uses atomics on every invocation after the first and only uses a mutex to synchronize the first caller with any concurrent callers. So, compilers. compiler writers are your friends. The code on the left side of the slide sucks. Well, the first one, you cannot really do much better than that, but at least you must rely on the compiler to generate nice, complicated addressing modes. In the second case, you can rely on the compiler to do strength reduction, change A of I to an iteration directly on the pointer, and maybe even have stuff like automatic increment addressing modes. The last example is doing two loads on every iteration, one to load the row pointer and one to load the value. So why not hoist the loading of the row pointer outside the loop and only do it once? Problem, all three of these actually rely on the compiler exploiting undefined behavior. The first one relies on the compiler extending 32 bits to 64 bits because RSI and RDI, one of them is A, one of them is I. They are 64-bit registers, and int I is 32 bits. So I plus 4 is not going to be computed in 32 bits. It's going to be computed in 64 bits. If it overflows, undefined behavior. If you change that int to unsigned, you're not going to get the nice addressing mode because overflow is not undefined on unsigned integers. Second case, what if n is the maximum integer? Loop on the left is infinite, right? It's always going to be less or equal than int max. So to actually change the loop to something on the left, you have to assume that you never have an overflow on int I as well. Last case is the dreaded strict aliasing. It's basically assuming that when you write A to of I of j, you don't write 42 into the row pointer. If you write 42 on the row pointer, and if the compiler actually allowed you to do that, then you really need to reload the row pointer on every iteration. So, compiler writers are your friends, but you need to help them, and you need to help them by paying some attention to undefined behavior. Good news is that most undefined behavior is obvious. You don't want the compiler to execute the program you wrote, but the way the compiler will reason about your program is not very different from how your brain will reason about the program. Sometimes, unfortunately, like in the case of type-based alias analysis, undefined behavior actually makes sense because that's an obvious optimization, isn't it? But still, the rules are really complicated. And there is some undefined behavior that seems to make no sense, but really should be left undefined, and this is the case with, for example, the atomics definition of atomics. So here I wrote, you don't want the compiler to execute the program you wrote, but you do want to have the program a program that does the same things as the program you wrote. So this is called sequential consistency. Sequential consistency is something that is related to distributed systems, so multiple threads is already a kind of distributed system. But the same concept also allows can be applied in a simplified way for a single thread. Sequential consistency says that the result of any execution is the same as read and write occurred in some total order, but especially, and this is the single-threaded case, operation from each individual processor must be ordered the same as in the program. Compiler cannot reorder reads and writes in a way that your program notices it. Of course, unless you invoke undefined behavior. So, with multiple threads, you can do more interesting stuff. Let's say that the compiler knows, for whatever reason, that F doesn't modify A. This can actually be rewritten this way. The plus plus A can be moved after F, because you know that F doesn't modify it. Now, this is not something that I expect compilers to do, but it's just a simple example. If you have two threads doing that, any side effect of F might be reordered in this case. You will see the side effect of F coming first, but A actually being 2 in the program. And the second F will have A equal to 1. So This is an example of an optimization that is perfectly legal in single-threaded code, but starts to be iffy on multi-threaded code. This is another one, 32-bit system, x equals 0, but you then assign minus 1. What is the printf going to print? Who says 0? Who says minus 1? Who says 2 to the 32nd minus 1? Somebody raised their hand, so. And of course, there's another big problem, that is compilers are complicated, but processors are even more complicated. And at least compilers are deterministic. They only do the optimization once. With the processor, everything can happen differently at runtime every time you run the program. You have multiple level of caches, connections within multiple sockets. And actually, the processor does really important optimizations. You also don't want the processor to execute the program that you want. You want the processor to have, at the very least, a store buffer. So the cool thing is that actually any optimization that the processor provides really can be described in the same way as the compiler optimizations, just moving loads and stores around in the program in a way that doesn't break the actual order seen by the program and expected by the programmer. So can we have some tool that lets you reason on both levels of transformations, compiler and processor? And finding such a tool and applying it as much as possible is exactly the approach that C and C++ takes. Of course, this is C, and you can have all sort of funny tools, such as unions, casts, whatever. And using them brings some responsibility to, and because the way they interact with optimizations is already interesting with one thread, imagine with many of them. So C and C++ committees said, OK, we have undefined behavior. Programs must be race-free. We say what is the data, what the data race is, and semantics of data races are left undefined. So that code before that did a minus one assignment and printf was just undefined behavior. So the correct answer was not 2 to the 32nd minus 1. The correct answer is 4 material drive. The cool thing about this approach is that if the program is compiler correct and has no data races, it is also correct according to the processor. Any compiler you will run, any target processor you will run, if your program is OK and doesn't have data races, you are guaranteed that it will run on strong memory ordering machine, weak memory ordering machine, anything. And also, if the program is correct, its execution are all sequentially consistent, which doesn't mean bug-free, but still, it's a start. So the key intuition behind the definition of data races is the, oh, by the way, yes, there is a guru switch that is allowed to make things not sequentially consistent. It's C after all. So the basic tool for determining whether there are data races is the happens before relationship. Two events can either be concurrent, so you have no idea which comes first, or one happens before the other. And if one event happens before the other, then you have a causal dependency between events, and you can actually use the events to communicate across threads. If they are concurrent, there are rules. And the rules is that if you have two accesses that are for the same memory location, one of them is a write, and at least one is not atomic, then game over, data race, undefined behavior. So on the other hand, if you have only reads, then no data race. So if you have like a write before you start the second thread, you can read without atomics, without locks, because it's effectively a constant. More precisely, we have acquire and release operations. Load acquire synchronizes with store release, and then the store happens before the load. But it must not be a random store and a random load. They must be a store release operation and a load acquire operation. Now, within the thread, program order provides the happens before relation. There is still some unspecified things with the sequence points, but you can just say that a semicolon means happens before. And another nice thing is that happens before is transitive. So everything before the store release in that thread also happens before everything after the load acquire in the other thread. I will give an example now. Okay, so these are two threads that execute a data race free and correct program. They assign something with a non-atomic store. They do a store release of that pointer, so foo is written into x. X is loaded by the other thread, and then x is foo ROA. Why is this correct? First of all, within each thread, you have happens before. So the assignment of the field and the loader of the field are well ordered with the store and the load. Now, because this is a store release to x and the other one is the load acquire from x, you also have happens before between the store release and the load acquire. And because happens before is transitive, you also have happens before between the assignment of the field and the loading of the field. This is what you have, for example, in a simple ring buffer. There's no concurrent accesses. Everything is properly ordered with the happens before relations. And there's no data race. Now, this instead is a problem, because you have two accesses, both of them non-atomic, so far so good. But the one on the left-hand side is right. So these two are concurrent. Data race undefined behavior. Another example, you have a store relaxed and load relaxed. This is the super guru switch, because store release and load acquire already are not guaranteed to be sequentially consistent if you don't use them correctly. But store relaxed and load relaxed are really up to 11. So concurrent access between x and x. And therefore, also data race, because the store is a write. However, you can use load relaxed and store relaxed in a perfectly safe way. Oh, yeah, sorry. By the way, of course, there's concurrent access there, so there's concurrent access also on the other one. Okay, this is more interesting. This is perfectly nice QEMU code, so we are kind of slowly introducing the Atomic.h primitives. You have atomic ink, which is nice and sequentially consistent, but on the other side, you have atomic read, which is the same as a relaxed load. This is still data race free, because they are concurrent, but they are both atomic, so there's no data race. There's no guarantee of sequential consistency, but no undefined behavior either, which is what you want. An important point about acquire release is that they also act as optimization barriers. This is the first example, the one that worked. The compiler, for no reason whatsoever, can move that assignment of foo ROA after the store release, and the other way around in the load acquire case. You have optimization barriers. And this is the other important characteristic of acquire and release semantics. Now, so far I've talked about loads and stores, but anything can be thought of an acquire and release operation, because, for example, lock and unlock of a mutex also have the same optimization barrier semantics as load acquire and store release. So let's talk about creating and joining a thread. Who thinks that create is acquire and join is release? No one. Wow, good. Who thinks that both of them are acquire or both of them are release? Oh, come on, you're cheating. You know that the right one is the last. So, indeed, create is the release one, and acquire is the join, and join is the acquire one. Why? Because create must show to the thread, to the new thread, anything that's been computed so far by the creator. And join must see everything that was computed by the other thread. Pthread once is acquire, because you must see anything that was computed during the initialization from the other thread. But the first time that you call it, it's also released because you are computing something and want to show it to the other thread. Signal and broadcast are released because, again, you want to show the outcome of what you've just done to the other thread. And pthread can't wait, it's both, because it unlocks the mutex, so it must be released. It locks the mutex, so it must be acquired. I wanted to ask you about all of them, but you weren't cooperative, so. So, C11 atomics work. Why? Because they do two very important things. They let threads access multiple shared data, mutable because one of the accesses for a data race is a write, and shared because they must be concurrent, so they must be in multiple threads, without causing data races. If you have multiple shared data and you don't use atomics, you get undefined behavior. And atomics work because they define happens before across threads, and together with the transitivity property, it makes also it also provides happens before for non-atomic accesses. Now, programs that correctly use locks behave as sequentially consistent because, again, it's not mutexes all the way down. There must be atomics at some point, and that's where you get the happens before across threads. And this happens before across threads, propagates all the way through the rest of the program. And because all compiler correct programs are also correct according to the processor, locks work. Lock define the write, acquire, and release behavior. That's it. Also, if you don't use so-called relaxed atomics that I've shown before, you are also guaranteed to be sequentially consistent. If you use relaxed atomics, you have to think about it. So let's see. This is C11 and C++ 11, which is not very... Well, now it is pretty commonly implemented by the compilers and without bugs. But let's say first time that compiler writers starting to pay attention about to concurrency was around, I think, 2003, 2002. It was on IX64. And this is way before C11. So we need some way to do it portably in QEMU. Because C11 atomics are only supported by very recent compilers. And so what we do in QEMU atomic.h is to limit to what older compilers can sort of emulate in some way. Also, C11 atomics have a very large API with all the acquire, release, and relax semantics, and so on. Few people can understand it, not including myself, by the way. So we start with something small, and later, if something turns out to be useful or turns out to be a model that we can wrap our head around, we add it. Also, C11 atomics have some rules that conflict with stuff that we used to do. In that case, we have foo arrow bar equal 1 equal x equal foo, and that's a write barrier that sort of acts like a store release. And on the other hand, with C11 atomics, the store after the barrier must be an atomic store. That store after the barrier is not atomic, so it can participate in the data race and cause undefined behavior. And we want to avoid this. First step is choose the kind of API that we want. So what do we want? We want everything that's sequentially consistent because that's the easy one to use. We want relaxed loads and stores because they are useful for like the stats example that I gave you before. We want RCU load and store because we have RCU. But we don't want, for example, acquire increment. We don't want release, compare, and exchange. Enough is enough. So those are definitely not something that we want. There's something legacy. The compiler barrier is really has like two or three uses in all of QEMU, but we are keeping it. And the memory barriers that we have are the Linux-style barriers, such as WMB, that don't require atomics on the on either side of the barrier. Maybe later we can convert those Linux-style memory barriers to C11-style memory barriers, and maybe even go directly to load, acquire, and store release. But for now, what we have is on the left side. So this is what the API looks like. MBRead and MBSet are sequentially consistent load and store. RCUread and RCUSet, you don't need to know exactly what they are, but you use them with RCU to publish something and to access something. Atomic read, atomic set are the relaxed load and store. Then you have the memory barriers, and you have all the sequentially consistent read, modify, write operations, compare and exchange, and all those built on top. Now, portable atomics are perfectly usable, but they are a bit less safe than C11. In C11, actually, you don't have to use the verbose thing. That you can just write underscore atomics. It's like const and volatile. It's nice. It's type safe. It turns plus equal into a fetch and add operation automatically. It's pretty nice. And as I showed before, with the write memory barrier, the semantics between C11 and compatibility legacy primitives are sometimes a bit different. So how do we achieve this compatibility? We have volatile and ASM to synchronize, to block optimization, to achieve that part of the acquire and release semantics. But these provide no synchronization for multiple threads. For those, we have the sync built-ins that started in the IA64 compilers. And these are exactly what we want, the read, modify, write, sequentially consistent primitives. Sync. There is also sync synchronize that is a full memory barrier. There's no read memory barrier and write memory barrier. For those, we use ASM. It's not perfect. Just like there were some problems with C11 atomics, there's also some problems with pre-C11 atomics. Basically, we are exploiting the compiler's behavior for volatile and ASM. And this is not 100% what we want. Because, for example, C11 atomics are guaranteed to be atomic. That's why they call them atomics. While volatile accesses aren't. This is, again, the long example from before. On some 32-bit machines, there's no way to make an atomic 64-bit store. The way to do that is just to not use atomic for something that's wider than a pointer. For something that's a pointer or smaller, you just cross your fingers and hope that what you get is atomic, which is a pretty good guess unless you're running on the very first alphas that didn't have byte writes. As I mentioned before, there's no lightweight memory barriers, only the full sync synchronize. And also there's no sequentially consistent loads and stores. Sequentially consistent loads and stores can be built on top of the lightweight memory barriers. You use ASM either for the lightweight memory barriers or for all of the stuff that's missing. Now, QEMU/atomic.h is kind of messy because it has all these pre-C11 hex based on volatile and all that. Just keep them all in there. Never use ASM for atomics outside this header. On the other hand, if it's really, really necessary for some reason you want an acquire increment, do that. Wrap it in some kind of function. You can use it outside qemu/atomic.h, but never bother about super optimizing with pre-C11 compilers. The corollary is that whenever you kind of you have this kind of optimization, you only target C11 atomics. So qemu/atomic.h is not limited to the sequentially consistent primitives. It has something more like the memory barriers and the relaxed loads and stores. So we can define some subsets that are pretty safe. For example, this is just the sequentially consistent subset. Sounds good. This is the RCU subset. You just use RCU read to read RCU pointers and RCU set to write RCU pointers. This is safe, and it's documented in the RCU documentation. This is also kind of safe, starts getting a bit more complex, but basically you just do normal reads and stores that have no ordering whatsoever and use the memory barriers to figure out the ordering, to help the compiler figure out the order that you desire. If you go up a notch, you get the statistics case, where you have statistics that are incremented or accounting, and another thread that reads the value for the statistic. On the other hand, it's really, really tempting to use this for more than statistics, which is why I've called it the less safe subset. So future work. How do we go from this to a more C11 world? This is what we have and what we keep. But this is what we have. Yes, sorry. And what we are going to do now is modernize the old code using the memory barriers. So use atomic read and atomic set so that we can really 100% respect the rule that anything that's done in multiple threads concurrently must use atomic accesses if one of the accesses is write. We can do it in two ways. We can change the straight assignment to atomic set, or we can introduce atomic load acquire and atomic store release and merge the barrier and the write into a single store release. This basically will undo some workaround that we have. The workaround that we have added a compiler fence around the memory barriers to make them really an optimization barrier, even more than the compiler is already considering it a barrier. It's a hack, and we want to get rid of it, of course. Another interesting point is that seclock protected fields should also use atomic read and atomic set. When you have a seclock, the reader reads in parallel with the write. So far, we've gotten around without the need to use atomic read and atomic set, because in the end we just expected the read to have a consistent set of values. But on the other hand, we're not respecting the C11 rule that when two accesses are concurrent and one of them is write, which is the case for seclock, both of them, both the read and the write, must be protected by seclock. So but must be accessed with atomics. So this is not a very big change because we only use seclocks in a couple of places, but it's a cleanup that we want to do, and this way we can also have a thread sanitizer work for seclocks. Another one is to change the Linux style barriers to the C11 barriers. The main difference is that of the various possibilities, Linux has barriers for everything, only ordering loads against loads, only ordering stores against stores, while C11 has this concept of the optimization barrier that I showed before. So an acquire operation should also block subsequent stores, and the release barrier should also block preceding loads. It's easy to do because they are supersets, the performance is more or less the same, so nice. And in fact, we're already relying on this because there is this snippet in the documentation of the QEMU Atomic.h header that says that load store barriers really are not part of the Linux API, but if you do a read memory barrier followed by a write memory barrier, you're going to get all three of them. It's not very good to rely on this, but it's basically an implementation detail that we already rely on, so why not just go to the C11 style barriers, because we do need load store barriers here and there. So hopefully this is where we'll get to. We'll have the same things that we have now with sequentially consistent operations. We'll keep the relaxed load store. And everything else will be based not so much on the Linux concepts that we inherited, but directly on the C11 concepts. So C11 style memory barriers, acquire barrier, release barrier, load acquire and store release directly. And also we are keeping RCU read and RCU set. RCU set is basically a store release. RCU read is more optimized than load acquire, and it's what the C11 standard calls a load, load consume. This is unfortunately not implemented by current compiler yet. They just treat it as a load acquire. It's not a big deal on x86 because everything is a load acquire on x86, but it's better to wait for compilers to do the optimization on ARM and PPC as well. So this is a nice quote from the experts. Atomics are like a chainsaw. Everyone can learn to use one, but don't let yourself get too comfortable with it. Any questions? Oh, I have some bonus material since I have time, actually. So, why do we have load acquire and store release rather than just the barriers? The reason is that the barrier is bidirectional. When you have a store release, the compiler is allowed to push stores after the store release before as much as it wants. I have shown before the picture with the optimization barriers, but these they were only going one way. When you have barriers, you can expect both the stores from above not to go below, but also the stores below will not move above the barrier. So the store barrier is stronger than the store release, and you can do the same thing for the load acquire. Actually, in the C11 memory model, it's really rare that you need a bidirectional barrier, but one very important case is, again, the seclock, which needs an acquire memory barrier. Then also for the bonus material, if anybody's interested, I can show you how the atomics are compiled. Just one thing. Look at the load sequentially consistent load for PowerPC. It's more expensive than the store of a sequentially consistent in a sequentially consistent manner. This is really ugly because programs usually have more loads than stores. Unfortunately, on PPC, the loads are more expensive than the stores. And this is basically the reason why you have everything else, because this is really expensive. If it weren't, nobody would bother with the guru switch. And then I have something else, but I'm not going to show it to you. It's too much. So why is that so complicated, so slow? It's because of this nice case, which of course never happened in practice, but if it happens, you get something really surprising. One thread writes one thread writes one, the other two threads read in the opposite order. With PowerPC, you can actually have the threads reading something inconsistent. So this thread believes that X was written before, this thread believes that Y was written before. And this is because of something called single copy atomicity. Who has ever heard of single copy atomicity? Whoa. So this is how you write the PowerPC code for that in the slide before, with a simple implementation. The store goes to the load, and the other store goes to the load. The problem is that so far, the first processor hasn't talked to the fourth, and the second processor hasn't talked to the third. The write of X is not visible to the other processor, and the write of Y is not visible to this other processor. So we have LWSync that talks to the first processor, LWSync that talks to the second processor, and now the processor gone reading the values, and nobody has told them of the synchronization between the third and the fourth processor, between the two readers. And so you get this problem. If you put the heavyweight memory barrier, you do the load, you do the store, but now sync talks to all the other processors in the system. And now they wait for each other, and you get everything nice and sequentially consistent. And now it's really all. So if you have questions, feel free to ask. Is that a good sign or a bad sign?
Just a comment. My general impression is, even for the kernel, that almost nobody really understands the semantics of memory barriers completely. So do you think that we're making it more complicated or more easy with the proposed changes?
I would have answered more complicated 3 months ago. I'm not at all sure now. After actually writing the slides, I think this is simpler. And anyway, the answer is abstract everything out of it, use atomics as less as possible except in low-level code and build on top of that.
Just use locks and...
No, not just locks. Just use RCU. RCU is chock full of atomics, but you don't notice. Okay.